We're going to begin. We started a mini series on business ethics. Last week was about greed. How many people have trouble with this particular characteristic? Greed is something that affects the entire world, not only certain people. The entire world is plagued by this problem. Tonight is going to be a similar topic, and it has to do with deception. I call it masters of deception. Why am I speaking about deception? Because the rabbis tell us that this world is olam hasheker. This world is very deceiving. What you see is not always real. People are not necessarily real. There's a lot of deceit going on, a lot of lies, a lot of falsehood. Especially right before Mashiach comes, right before the Messiah arrives, the generation before Mashiach, there's going to be a lot of, or I should say a lack of truth. And a lot of people will unfortunately be subjected to all types of lies. Even though this was always the case years ago, throughout the history of mankind, people always lied and there was always deception. Today with the mass media and communication, it's going to be a lot easier to reach people and to fool them, to cheat them, to mislead them. And the question is, how can we recognize that which is false, that which is deceiving? Well, if we're dealing with an individual, with one human being, a friend, a partner, you want to get to know him a little bit. The rabbis tell us, "B'shlosha dvarim adam nikar." One can tell a great deal about a person in three ways: bekoso, bekiso, ubekaaso. The way he drinks, how much he drinks, how does he act when he's drunk? Bekiso, with his purse, his pocket, how he spends, how much he spends. Is he generous? Is he stingy? And bekaaso, with anger. If you anger him, you make him upset, how does he react? In other words, there's several characteristics where we can evaluate, where we can judge more or less what this individual is all about, what kind of a human being he is. Three important areas. It won't tell you everything about him, but it will tell you a great deal. You're dating a girl, you're dating a boy, you may notice certain things. These are three areas to look for. I'm not telling you to get him drunk, but there are times where we can see how people behave in various situations. But there's something else here that I want to bring out. Rabbis tell us that character, in general, the character of a person is very much tested and can be seen in business. By doing business with him, you can learn a lot about him. What I want to do tonight is share with you a little bit of my curiosity that I've always had for many, many years, as to why people have a need to lie, to deceive, to cheat, to trick. Why should people want to do that? I've always been curious, what is pushing them to do it? Why is there an urge or a need for a person to come to that? Now, when we're talking about deceit, when we're talking about deception, we're no longer dealing necessarily with money here. That could be stealing. We called that greed last week. Deceit could be in many forms and fashions. It could be even amongst friends, husband and wife. There is all kinds of people who will fool you, who will cheat you. Beginning with the con artists. You heard about them? There's a lot of con artists. And they dress up very well. You may not be able to recognize who they are. And some of the most famous are politicians. They also will speak nice, dress nice, appear nice, but they're not necessarily saying the truth. You have unscrupulous marketers marketing all kinds of products that are not worth it, totally not worth it. And still, they make it sound like it's something that you have to get, that you have to buy. You're getting a good deal. Then you have all kinds of situations at work with workers, employees, who may not be doing their job. And maybe they're misleading you in thinking that they're a good employee, they're doing their job, and they're not. So there are many, many areas of life where we come across people who deceive, who misrepresent, mislead. One of the worst ones, however, or I should say the most dangerous one, is cult leaders. And in the past 30 years or so, more than 30 years, I recall at least three who have had a very, very powerful influence over many people, and as a result of some sort of manipulation of their mind, they committed suicide, all these people. There was even one group that belonged to an organization, Heaven's Gate, and I'm not going to mention names here, you can look it up yourself, cult leaders, where the leader was delusional, thought up of all kinds of strange ideas, that as soon as this big comet is going to come by, there's some extraterrestrial beings on that comet that they're going to join, that their body is going to be replaced with another body, and they're going to go into another dimension. Somehow people were sold on this. And eventually they committed suicide to be able to join this shuttle or this spaceship that was there somewhere coming along with this comet. I'm telling you, crazy ideas. There were other groups, other cults in South America, committed suicide in Texas. All kinds of people that it's so difficult to understand how in the world were they led to this? How did they believe so much in one individual? How did he manipulate their mind? How were they convinced? I think even psychologists are arguing about this till this day, trying to figure out the mentality of the cult leader and the mentality of all these people who were convinced and who agreed to commit suicide. So we're not going to get into all the psychology, all the possibilities of why these people went along with it. I wanted to just give you an example of how an individual, whether he is delusional or not, makes no difference. In the end, he manipulated, he misled, he convinced a lot of people to do something terrible. And these people exist out there. My way of understanding these individuals, these leaders, is through something called self-deception. Now, self-deception is not something so simple to understand. They have argued a lot about this, the experts, the psychologists. What is self-deception? Is it really possible? How could a person deceive himself? But it exists. We know that it exists at various levels. And basically, it's a person who believes in his own lies, even though it contradicts something else that he believes in. Somehow he's sold on this. Somehow he cannot remove himself from this, even though he knows deep down that this may not be logical or true. He's deluding himself. So there are people out there that have this weakness, this self-deception. They're deceiving themselves. And that gives them the strength to go ahead and deceive others as well. When you look at a movie, and I'm not necessarily encouraging to look at movies, but on TV, for those of you who have seen various movies or shows, usually you can identify who's the good guy and who's the bad guy. Right? There's a good guy and there's a bad guy. And usually, the way Hollywood has it, is that the good guys always win. But anyway, somehow we can identify. We see it on the TV, and we can see the difference between the good guy and the bad guy. But I want to ask you a question. What differentiates the good guy from the bad guy? Who is to say he is the good guy and he's the bad guy? What makes one good and one bad? We think we know. We think we know. We think we can differentiate between good and bad. But I have some news to tell you. There's a famous saying by the, I think it was a poet, a French poet, Charles Baudelaire. I'm going to say it in French and then I'll translate. La plus belle des ruses du diable est vous persuader qu'il n'existe pas. One of the best tricks of the devil is to persuade you, to convince you that he doesn't exist. In other words, there is something out there that is making us forget or not perceive a certain reality. In other words, we think that we are able to differentiate, we think that we have clarity, we think that we will not be fooled or tricked, but we forget that there is a trickster out there. There is a master deceiver, a manipulator, the Satan, the Yetzer Hara, the evil inclination. We forget about that. We think we know the difference. We don't always know the difference. That is why the rabbis tell us that the seal of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, the seal of God, is emet, is truth. What does that mean? The seal of God is emet? How do you understand that? What does it have to do with the seal? Why emet? When you seal, when you stamp something, you want it to stand out. You want it to be revealed. You want something to be exposed, to be seen. Hashem wants people to see Him. Hashem wants people to realize that He exists. That this is the truth, and it's the only truth. His seal is really everywhere. His fingerprints are throughout the world, throughout the universe. The reason why it's truth and not anything else, because the human being cannot become complete unless he adapts this characteristic called truth. In order for the human being to reach his real potential, to be what he can be, he can only do so with this seal, with this midah, with this characteristic called emet. Emet is what makes one complete. And in order for us to understand this, if you look at the first few words of Bereshit of Genesis, Bereshit bara Elokim, in the beginning God created the world, the last letter of each one of those three words stands for emet. Bereshit is Taf, bara is Aleph, Elokim is Mem. The three letters make up the word, the Hebrew word emet, truth. In other words, God created the world with emet. Why with emet? Because emet is only one. Sheker, falsehood, there's a lot. There's all kinds of falsehoods out there. But what is God telling us? Other than for mankind to be complete, he has to adapt truth. God is also telling us that the world cannot exist, this world that he created, can only exist aladin v'la'emet v'la'shalom, as the rabbis tell us. Only if there's justice, only if there's truth, and only if there's peace. If you lack any one of these three, the world will self-destroy. We've had wars. Why? Because there's no din, there's no emet, there's no shalom. What we're being told from the very beginning of creation, that emet is so important, but be careful. Don't think, as important as emet is, that you can just hold on to it, grab it, adapt it. There is a very powerful koach ataya. There's a very, very powerful force out there that God created that misleads. Hataya, it misleads people. Where do we see that message? That's the whole story with the serpent, with the Nahash. The Torah is not telling us stories here, fairy tales about a serpent that seduced Chava, that convinced her in Adam. What's this all about? This is about the chief or master deceiver of all, the Nahash, the evil inclination, the Satan, the devil. Therefore, what we have as a counterpart to the seal of truth that symbolizes the exact opposite, symbolizing sheker, falsehood, is this evil inclination that will do the exact opposite of what is true, it will try to forge. It will try to mislead and cheat and fool. The exact opposite of what truth stands for, what truth represents. This other force will attempt to falsify, to mislead us to believing that there's something else out there. Why would he want to do that? Now, I've already explained that there's a need for the two of them to enable free will. But what's pushing him? And according to the Kabbalah, what's pushing the evil forces to do what they do is survival. In order for it to survive, it has to continue to mislead people. It has to have as many customers as possible. That's what gives him power. What gives the Satan, what gives the evil inclination power, what empowers him, is more and more customers who will live their life according to his philosophy. And when that happens, God forbid, the truth is lacking. The divine providence or the divine revelation on earth appears to be very dim and is concealed more and more, because this is so much more powerful, unfortunately. Just remember this little point. What motivates or what pushes this power to continue to do what it does to people is survival. That reveals to us a little bit of why people, human beings, want to cheat and want to lie. Deep down in their subconscious minds, somehow they're being misled to believe their survival depends on this. If I want to survive, then I gotta cheat. I gotta lie. I gotta cover up. I gotta mislead. Otherwise, I will not survive. Otherwise, I won't have it my way. Otherwise, I won't make it. People think like that. That the only way you can do business and earn a living is through lying and cheating and misleading others. They actually told this to me. Businessmen told me, if you don't lie and you don't cheat, then you're not going to make money. They actually believe that. And it's so untrue. So there's something there that is connecting their way of thinking with what the evil inclination represents, or what the evil inclination wants, and that is to survive. And that is so wrong. One of the most powerful forces out there that is complete deception is witchcraft, which we'll talk about another time. How does witchcraft work? What is it exactly? How could they have so much power, those who use witchcraft? But all I will say right now is that this is complete deception, completely not true. There are certain kinds of witchcraft that if they come in contact with water, it cancels them out, it neutralizes them. They go back to being what they were originally, before they were changed as a result of witchcraft. Because witchcraft is not real. It cannot last. Its effect is not permanent, because it's not real. But it's an illusion. People actually think there's something there. It appears to be that there's something there. It is very powerful indeed. But it's based on sheker. It's false. It's not real. It's therefore a very, very powerful source of deception. If you read the Torah, therefore you will find only one place where the Torah says, stay away, keep your distance. From what? From sheker. Midvar sheker tirchak. Distance yourself from falsehood. You don't see the word tirchak, distance yourself from anything else. It says don't do that, don't eat this. But tirchak, stay away at all costs. Stay away, keep a distance from sheker. You don't want to associate with that. You don't want to have anything to do with that which is false, that which is wrong, that which is misleading. You don't want to belong to that club. It's a very dangerous club. Which club should you belong to? The Torah says very clearly, "Vehalachta bidrachav." Walk in the path of God. Emulate His ways. Be like Him. The rabbis tell us that the more one cherishes the truth, the more one is willing to sacrifice even his personal gain for the truth, the closer he will be to emulating God's ways, and the stronger the relationship with God will be. It all depends on this midah, this characteristic called truth. For those who want more detailed information about truth and falsehood, I've already covered those topics in three lectures when we did a series about refinement of one's character. You have a lecture about honesty, about truth, and about falsehood. So there's no reason for me to repeat all the details or all the examples of those three areas, but I think we need to cover at least a few examples of some that we take for granted, that we think that's not so bad, but in the end, they really belong to that camp, the camp of deception. So I'm going to give you a few examples. First area in Hebrew is called Ona'at Mamon, deceit in areas of money. What's a form of deceit in areas of money if you're in business? Overcharging. Overcharging more than what you're supposed to. Taking advantage of people's ignorance, not knowing what something is really worth. Or just because nobody else has it, you take advantage of the people, you know, they have to come to you, and therefore you're going to hike up the price. All of that is ona'at mamon. You're abusing them. You're cheating them in the area of money. Or here's another example that I've seen a lot of times. Somebody wants to sell a used car and he tells the buyer, the potential buyer, I'm selling it to you as is. When he knows, the seller, that as is really concealing some problem. Maybe the transmission is no good. You have to tell the buyer, listen, the transmission is not good. I can deduct so much for the transmission. It's up to you if you want to buy it, but at least he was upfront about it. Just saying as is, thinking that this is covers you, no, it doesn't cover you if you know. Now, if you don't know that there's a problem there, that's something else. I'm selling it to you as is, but I don't know. It's used, it's a used car. That's different. But when you know the truth and you're misleading, cheating him, that's stealing. You're not only cheating, I mean, you're stealing. Then you have ona'at devarim. You have various examples of where people abuse others verbally. There's several kinds of examples. What does it mean to cheat or abuse or mislead people verbally? Let's say you come into a store that sells all kinds of hardware, computers, and you don't want to buy. You're not buying. How much is this? How much is that? Why are you taking his time? Why are you giving him the impression that you're going to buy? He's going to work hard. He thinks that you're a serious buyer. But you're not. You're misleading him. You're using words to mislead. Now, if you're shopping around and you want to compare prices, that's fine. You tell him, listen, I'm shopping around, I want to compare, can you tell me how much this is? That's different. You tell him up front. Don't lead him on to think that you're going to buy when you're not buying. That's a form of cheating, of misleading. Rabbis tell us that there's another kind of abuse, which is reminding someone of his past, when that past was not so good. Somebody that was on drugs, alcoholic, criminal, and he's gotten over it, and now he's part of the community, trying to do things right, and you tell him one day, oh, I remember you, 10 years ago, you were in jail, you were doing this. It's a form of abuse using words to put someone down. Even though this is not misleading, it's still a form of abuse. Verbal abuse that is also prohibited. Another example is, let's say somebody arrives in a city where he doesn't know his way around. And he asks you, can you tell me how to get there, how to get to this place? And you give him the opposite direction. You send him off in the wrong direction, intentionally. Or you do all kinds of things like that to mislead people. That's wrong. That's misleading. People do this, and they think it's just a joke. This is not a joke. This is serious. Another one is gnevat dat. Gnevat dat, what means to steal someone's mind? How do you steal someone's mind? Rabbis tell us in the Midrash, there's seven kinds of thieves. You thought it was one? There's seven. The first one is the one, shegonev dat chavero, the one who steals the mind of his friend. What's that? How do you steal someone's mind? In English, it's called misrepresentation. This we see a lot of. The packaging, the labeling of something which is really not correct. They tell you it's 100% pure, some sort of juice, and it's not. It's just the label is misrepresenting. Now this is against the law. If it's really misrepresenting, it's even against American law. But sometimes you can get away with it. If you put in small little letters that most people can't read or are not going to bother reading, or they have to take out their reading glasses, you know, it's not fair. When companies know this, they know that people can be easily fooled by the packaging, by the picture, by the logo, by the labels, in selling them something which is sugar water. That's what it is. And they're calling it some exotic drink that will make you healthy. And even doctors will tell you it will eliminate the chances of cancer, or reduce, I should say, the chances of cancer. All kinds of stories. This is called gnevat dat, misrepresentation. This is also deception. It's the same camp. It's the same kind of thing. You go to the grocery store, go to a place where they sell fruits and vegetables, and they're selling strawberries. Beautiful strawberries, but the bottom, they're all rotten. The ones on top are beautiful, shiny, big, and red. That's gnevat dat. Because your first impression, oh, this must all be good. People who are smart, usually turn it over. So, you're good, huh? You're professional, exactly, yeah. But most people are not. You know, some people are so innocent, they think, he would never do something like that. But he's a businessman. And most businessmen think alike. They're interested in making money here. And, you know, this is what will sell. My favorite example, and the one that really bothers me all the years, is how could you put on something $9.99? Why don't you just be truthful and say it's $10? No, it's $9.99. You're getting a deal here. It's not $10. It's $9.99. Come on. What? You know why they do this? Why do they do this? Huh?
Thinking 9 instead of the 10.
Because you're thinking 9, it's not 10. So they're that's a form of manipulation of the mind. There's all kinds. I'm just giving you a few examples that I thought of.
And it works.
Of course. You know, I once asked somebody who's into advertisement, tell me, your company spends millions of dollars on advertisement, and I see it in town. I don't look at it. I buy what I want for myself. You know, if there's 10 shampoos, I'm going to buy what I need, what I know works for me. Why would I buy what you're advertising? So you know what he told me? If everybody would think like you, we would be out of business. Most people will buy that shampoo, that product that's in on the advertising, especially if there's a movie star holding it. And even more so if a nice-looking woman is holding it. For sure, that's going to attract even more people to buy it. This is what sells. Can you do this? They'll tell you, this is business. They'll tell you, welcome to America. This is the capitalistic system. Right? All kinds of stories of why this is permissible. But listen, if the product is really good, fine, then go ahead and advertise it. But what if it's not as good as others? In Israel, there's some advertisement with beer. Beer, you know? Who do they put drinking beer? a very muscular looking young man, and it says in Hebrew, Tishte makabi tiye gever. You know, if you drink makabi, you be a man. In other words, if you don't drink makabi, you're not a man. If you drink some, this is really misleading. The beer is good beer, they're all good beers. But why say something like that? Why mislead, intentionally mislead people to think that way? And that's what they're trying to do. And they'll tell you, they'll admit it. And they say it's not wrong, nothing wrong with it. Nothing wrong according to their books, but according to his books and his rules, it is wrong. It's wrong to mislead. It's pure and simple. There's no two ways about it. Then there is another one. You want to sell something, whether it's your house or a car or, I don't know, a piece of furniture, and it doesn't look good. It's used and old. You go ahead and paint it. It's broken, dilapidated. And you know that if you paint it and give it a nice finish, paint finish, it will sell. It's wrong. This is misleading. Now, if your house is in great shape, it really is good shape, no termite damage, everything fine about it, you just want it to look more presentable, and you fix up the gardening in the front, and you have a fresh coat of paint, and you clean out all the cobwebs around the house, that's fine. Then you make it more presentable. I mean, after all, isn't that why the bride goes to her wedding with a beautiful gown, with all her makeup? She wants to look good. And she wants to look good, especially for her husband, not for other people, especially for her husband. You know, maybe he changed his mind by now, right? So she wants to look good. That's okay. You know, she is a nice looking person, but she wants to really look good. This is the happiest day of her life. Fine. But to mislead people so that they can pay you more than what it's really worth just by painting and covering it up, come on. It's not right. Then we have another area called Lifnei Iver Lo Titen Michshol. The Torah says, don't put a stumbling block before a blind person. He's blind. It doesn't mean physically blind. He's not aware. He doesn't know any better. You put a stumbling block. That means you make him stumble. You make him fall. He will make a mistake. What would be an example of this? You know, we go sometimes to brokers. They may want to give us a loan, if it's a loan broker, or if it's a real estate agent or broker, depending on the type of broker. People really think, at times, that the broker has their best interest in mind. And it's not true. It's very sad to say, very, very sad to say that usually brokers have their commission in mind. Not your best interest, necessarily. First of all, it's what's in their best interest. A real estate agent wants to sell you a house. Do you think he's concerned that the house is safe? If the foundation, the structure is sound? No. He's going to get his 3%. That's what he wants. And he'll praise the height of the ceilings. Look at this Spanish style. Look at all the appeal that it has. Well, this is a good investment for you. And it's close to the shopping, and it's close to your job. All kinds of stories. Now, I can understand if it's a close friend who wants a little bit to convince something that based on his best judgment is a good buy, fine. But if he's not a very close friend, I would be suspicious. But people usually fall for it. Because usually, and I don't want to give all brokers or agents a bad name, but that's the facts of life. That first and foremost on their mind is the commission. Not the best interest, necessarily not. Not the best interest of the buyer. And that's wrong. You really want the best. You should want the best for him, don't you? Well, he's not a friend, he's not a relative, he's just a customer, a client, or, you know. And you know, it's okay, it's a good deal. Did you look into it? Would you buy it for yourself? A stockbroker, the same thing. He might tell you this is a good investment and it's a very bad investment. Junk bonds. He wants a commission. He may not be so careful. There's a lot of people that will sell you something that you don't need. Oh, this is good. You'll be so happy you bought it. And they know you don't need it. It's going to sit in the garage gathering dust. They know it. If they don't know, it's something else. And they're telling you it's good. It's a good deal. It's on sale. Once in a lifetime in a sale. And they know you don't need it. Why sell it to him? Why convince him? That's misleading. This big area of misleading is very hard to prove that the individual really intended to mislead. That is why the Torah adds a special phrase after telling us not to do this. V'yareta melokecha ni Hashem. Fear God, for I know the truth, Hashem says. Why does it say it in this area? Because these are dvarim ha-mesurim la-lev. These are things that only one's heart knows. It's hard to prove. He tells, I didn't know the transmission was gone. How are you going to prove it? It's in the heart. God can read the heart. So God knows the truth. V'yareta melokecha, therefore, if you're about to do something that no one will ever find out the truth, well, just remember, He knows the truth. So fear God. This area of business ethics is not easy. It presents a tremendous challenge for many people, even if they have emunah, even if they believe in God. We're talking about money here. We're talking about survival. We're talking about people who think that this is the way to do business. They actually believe it's okay. They don't see anything wrong with it if everybody else does it. Well, let me tell you something. The greatest proof, the one is amiti, the one is truthful, the one is sincere, the one is God-fearing. The greatest test of that is when everybody else is doing the wrong thing and he doesn't. Because that makes it so much more difficult. When everybody else is doing it that way, everybody else is doing it. And he does not, and he resists the temptation not to be like them. That is the greatest proof, the greatest test to see if one has integrity or not, if one is truthful or one is deceitful. Because you can easily fall. Everybody else is doing it. But it's deceit, it's misleading, it's cheating, it's wrong. Well, it takes somebody who's very, very strong and realizes that this is wrong to be able to resist it. So this is a real test to see if someone is honest or not. When everybody else is doing the wrong thing and he says, I'm not going to be like them. Okay, so now we've come to the point of asking ourselves, what can we do to help ourselves not fall into this trap? There's a lot of deceit out there. And the master deceiver is working very hard to get more and more customers on his side. So what do we do? Can we really survive? Can we really remain righteous, honest people in the area of business or in any other area? Is it possible? The answer is yes, it is still possible. And that is why the Torah tells us, Ve'afta et Hashem Elokecha b'chol levavecha u'b'chol nafshecha u'b'chol me'odecha. Love your God with all your heart, b'chol nafshecha, even if it means giving up your life, u'b'chol me'odecha, and with all your possessions. And one of the questions raised about this is, why say with all your possessions? We already said b'chol levavecha, love God with all your heart. Why add with all your possessions? So the rabbis tell us, some people love their body, some people love more their money. And they're not willing to give it up. There's a famous comedian, I forgot his name, who said the following joke. He was once stopped by a robber with a gun. He says, your money or your life? And he said, and I told him, well, let me think about it. Give me a minute to think about it. You know what this joke says? Pretty much tells us the answer to this question. Why say bechol meodecha? Because there will be some people that will say, go ahead, my life, or my money, or whatever. There are some people who will choose their money and give up their life. And for that reason, Hashem says, bechol meodecha, love me with your money. Don't love your money more than you love me. Do things right, even though it means that you have to give up your money. So because you have individuals who care more about their money than care about their life, it says, love your God with everything you have. It all depends on the individual. In other words, this commandment is geared towards everyone, depending what's more valuable to that individual. Okay, I want to love God with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my money. How do I go about it? There are a lot of temptations. There are a lot of challenges. People say it's very difficult to be honest. Where do we start? What's the best place to start? So I think I'm going to suggest just a few easy ideas of where everyone, whoever wants to really begin to train himself to be an honest person, to be a truthful person, and not to cheat and to deceive others. This is a place where it's easy to start. Number one, train yourself not to flatter people. Now, be tactful, yes. To be nice to people and to be tactful, to be diplomatic, to be correct, yes. But don't flatter because you want his favor. Chaplusi in Farsi. Okay? Don't flatter. Lo lachnof, chanufa in Hebrew. Yeah. When you want a favor from him, you smile to him and you say nice words to him with the intent of getting something from him. People do this. This can be controlled. It's not easy, but it can be controlled. This is a place where one can start. Don't flatter. Don't mislead someone. You know, by saying words that you would not say otherwise, but because you want his favor, you want his help, you want a job, you're flattering him. Be careful not to flatter. Number two, a promise is a promise. La'amod badibur. You said you will do something, do it. As much as possible. You committed yourself to do something that is feasible, do it. You have to push it off a little bit, fine. Do it. You said something to someone that you will do, you will give, you will help, do it. A word is a word. Make sure that you are truthful. How? By keeping your promises. Number three, admit mistakes. You were wrong, admit it. It's so hard for people. It's very hard. People want to cover it up, they want to conceal, they want to mislead, they want to lie. Try hard to at least once in a while, even once in a while, admit a wrong, admit a mistake. It will go a long way. The next one, I think, is very, very much overlooked. Very much overlooked. I've noticed it too much. Is that people allow themselves to use something that belongs to someone else without asking his permission. In certain countries, every phone call you make costs money. Here, in America, there are certain plans that, you know, unlimited calling. So, there's no expense. But it used to be, I remember seeing this, people would be invited over someone's home and without asking permission, they would just pick up the phone and make a phone call. Did you ask permission? You know it costed him? Even though it's 10 cents, it makes no difference. People who do not ask for permission in using something that belongs to someone else, especially if there's an expense to it, they're ganavim, they're thieves. A thief is not just $10 million, a thief eats it for 10 cents. Not asking permission, taking something that is not yours, regardless of how much it is. That shows that this person is not honest. I wouldn't trust him. That, to me, is already enough. I've seen enough. That already tells me something. Now let me share with you what I've noticed when I was a young man studying in the yeshiva. In Israel, you recall, there used to be something called an asimon.
Yeah.
It's a token that would be used in the phones. Instead of putting real money, you would put a token. So sometimes people approach me, do you have an asimon for me? Do you have, you know, one of these tokens, one of these chips? I said, okay, here's one. And it's about 25 cents. Yeah. 9 out of 10 would not give it back to me. Maybe 8 out of 10 would not give it back to me. One of them I saw every time he borrowed, he wrote it down that he borrowed from me and he gave it back. What did I learn from this? The other ones that never gave back, I can't lend them again. That would be wrong of me to lend them. And I don't have to embarrass myself to go ask them, oh, by the way, you owe it to me. So I felt very uncomfortable, it's very awkward. And if they would ask me, do you have an asimon, I would say no. And I wouldn't be lying. Why not? I don't have to give for you. I have to give to someone else. Those I have, but not for you. You know? It's awkward. It's uncomfortable telling the person, listen, you don't return what you took. You know, you can't trust you. Can't do business with you either. So therefore, this is an additional idea. You borrowed even the quarter from someone, make sure you give it back to him as soon as possible, even though it's all it is a quarter. I cannot stand it. If I had to, for some reason, borrow anything from anybody, it'll bother me. I won't be able to go to sleep that night until I give it back. I don't want to owe. I took something from someone else. Give it back as soon as possible. Those that don't give it back, and there are those who don't want to give it back. Not that they forget, they don't want to. It's coming to me, he has enough money. They come up with all kinds of excuses. He's rich anyway. Oh, his father will give him some more. You'd be surprised how many excuses the Yetzer Hara, the evil inclination, comes up with. But what does it all show? Dishonesty, deception, lies. Can you do business with them? No, I wouldn't. The Lubavitcher Rebbe said something very powerful. The last Lubavitcher Rebbe. He says, people are looking for all kinds of ways to grow spiritually, to become better people. And Chassidut teaches that meditation and prayer can help one a lot. But he said as follows, meditation and prayer, while spiritually transformative, do not match the power of doing business ethically. Doing business ethically, being an ethical person, an honest person, will do a lot more for the individual than meditation and prayer. Then we must not forget the damage that deception or misleading people causes. Especially if they believed in you. You had a good name, and all of a sudden they found out that you were dishonest about something. It causes a tremendous chilul Hashem. There's a disrespect for God's name. Look at this guy, this supposedly religious guy, did something so terrible. He's just as bad as all the rest of them then. All the rest of the criminals. He does damage to himself too. He doesn't realize. But the more one commits these kinds of deceits, he's doing damage to himself, to his character. But here we're talking about also the damage that one does to the name of God and to the rest of the community. People might think, listen, if he does this, perhaps there's others just like him. They're all a bunch of thieves. That's the name he may give others who are really innocent and good people. Tremendous damage can come out of that, of one individual committing a terrible crime. and I don't like mentioning names, but you all know who I mean, of the most recent Ponzi scheme that caused so much, not only aggravation, pain, loss, but people killed themselves as a result of this man's schemes. And this falls under the category of greed as well as deception. And this has existed. What a shame that people have succumbed to this weakness of dishonesty, of trying to manipulate people, trying to mislead them just to gain a few more dollars. On the other hand, if one conducts himself properly, behaves himself, deals with his customers honestly, whether it's in weights and measures, or he's careful, or whether it's with anything that he does, that he's careful, you know, not to mislead people. People will notice that. People will take notice of one who's honest. And then you have the opposite effect. You have the Kiddush Hashem. You have God's name being sanctified. Look what an honest man this is. His parents are so lucky, so fortunate. As the rabbis tell us, Ashrei Yolato, fortunate are the ones that gave birth to him. So much good comes out when an individual conducts himself in such a pleasant way with people, a charitable way, in an honest way. He sanctifies God's name. And last but not least, the Torah reminds us, Kedoshim Tehiyu, be holy. Strive to be holy. Don't be tied down to materialism. Elevate yourself by forming a stronger connection with God. This will help you be more ethical. This will help you guard against all the forces of evil that are trying to mislead. We need protection. We need strength. It's very difficult if one lives in a world that is full of lies to be ethical and to be honest. There are people in all religions and faiths that are honest, righteous, and good. But unfortunately, there are very few. The Torah therefore tells us, Kedoshim Tehiyu, if you follow the path of being a holy people, a holy nation, you will have it easier not assimilating to the corrupt ways of others. Otherwise, if you don't strive to be holy, to be better, to be above everybody else, you may fall in the same trap that they did. You may succumb, and you may be dragged along with the trend of this is what everybody's doing. You don't want to be like everybody. If everybody's doing the wrong thing, then strive to be holy. There was once a non-Jew who approached Hillel. He says, Hillel, I want to convert to Judaism, but on condition that you teach me the entire Torah while standing on one foot. Hillel tells him, Ma de'alech sneh lo ta'avid lechavrach. What is hateful for you, do not do to your fellow human. He tells him, that's the whole Torah. The rest is commentaries. What you don't want people to do to you, then don't do it to others. I don't think anybody who's deceiving, misleading others wants people to mislead and deceive him. So if he were to stop for a moment and think to himself, wait a minute, what am I doing? I don't want others doing this to me. Maybe this will help him. This is something that people don't think about, but this is the truth. Hillel said something very powerful. This is the whole Torah. Don't do unto others what you don't want them to do to you. Do for them what you want them to do for you. And ultimately, the Torah says it's our choice. We have free will. We can choose whichever path in life we want. There's a path of life, and there's a path of death. There's a right and there is a wrong. Therefore, the Torah says, be careful, uvacharta b'chaim, that you choose life. Be very, very careful when you make a choice. Be very, very careful before you do something that is questionable. Ask yourself, is this leading me to life, or is this leading me in the opposite direction? People were to think a little bit more about what they do, and to consult perhaps with those areas that they have any questions, whether something is ethical or not, then God willing, they will stay in the path of life, the path of Emet, the path of Hashem.
Okay? So,